In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. My dear brother and sister, fraternal greetings to you from the Carmelite Fathers, and warm welcome to Carmel Light, reflection on the day's readings. It's the 14th of June, Monday of the 11th week in Ordinary Time. This day is marked as World Blood Donor Day by World Health Organization, WHO. And today we remember Blessed Maria Candida of the Eucharist, a Carmelite virgin, about whom Larissa will give us more details.
On 14 June, we venerate Blessed Maria Candida of the Eucharist, born Maria Barba, who was an Italian Roman Catholic professed religious of the Discalced Carmelites. Her devotion to the Eucharist was a focal point for her spiritual thinking and her own life, and she wrote to an extensive degree on the Eucharist and its importance. Maria Barba was born on 16 January 1884 in Catanzaro as the 10th of 12 children to the Appellate Court Judge Pietro Barba and Giovanna Flora. She was baptized on the following 19 January. Her parents and siblings all hailed from Palermo but moved to Catanzaro while her father was in that town during a brief assignment. In 1886, the family returned to Palermo. In 1891, Maria began her time at school and achieved excellent grades while there. She completed her studies in 1898. That same year, she began to learn the piano. On 3 April 1894, she made her first Holy Communion, and from that point on, fostered a special devotion to the Eucharist and developed what she referred to as her vocation for the Eucharist. Barba despaired at not being able to receive it on a frequent basis. In 1899, she felt a strong calling to the religious life as she reflected before an image of the Sacred Heart and would call this experience her transformation. And the 2nd July 1899 vesting of her cousin as a nun augmented this desire. The girl informed her parents of her decision, but her parents opposed this, believing it nothing more than initial spiritual fervor rather than an actual desire. But Barba's devotion grew after learning about the charism of the Carmelites, which inspired her more through reading the journal of Thérèse of Lisieux. This also encouraged her to persevere despite being rejected, and she continued to wait for the time when she would achieve her dream. Her father died on 21st June 1904. In September 1910, she and her mother and siblings undertook a pilgrimage to Rome and met Pope Pius X in an audience. The girl later made her confirmation at a rather advanced age on 12 November 1912. Her mother died on 5 June 1914. Barba could not receive the Eucharist on a frequent basis as her brothers would not allow her to go out on her own, so she compiled so as to not offend them. Barba waited for 2 decades before she could enter the Order's convent at Ragusa on 25th September 1919, and the Cardinal Archbishop of Palermo, Alessandro Lualdi, encouraged her to enter and fulfill her desire to become a nun. Her entrance into the Order saw her assume the religious name of Maria Candida of the Eucharist on 16th April 1920, after receiving the habit. Barba made her initial profession on 17th April 1921 and later made her perpetual profession on 23rd April 1924. In 1924, her period of formation came to a close and she was elected as the prioress of the convent on 10th November. She held this position until 1947 and was reconfirmed in that position on 5 separate occasions. Barba worked hard with caution to revive the spirit of their foundress, and under her able leadership, the convent grew to a point where a new foundation could be made in Syracuse. The prioress also helped to secure the return of the friars of the order to the Sicilian region. Barba spent hours before the Eucharist. None of her brothers ever visited her, having grown to resent her decision, and did not even attend the celebration when she was first vested with the order's habit. On 19 June 1933, the Feast of Corpus Christi, the nun began writing the book that served as a record of her own personal experiences and reflections on Eucharistic meditations, and this was completed in 1936. The book also records deepening theological reflections on those personal experiences of hers. On 16 June 1922, she had started writing up First Steps on her vocation and arrival to the order, while later on 5th November 1926, beginning Mountain Song at the request of her confessor on her Carmelite life. Barba was first diagnosed with a tumor in her liver back in 1947. She died of cancer on the evening of 12 June 1949, and her remains were interred at Ragusa the following 14th June. Her remains were later relocated on 12 November 1970. The beatification process opened on 15th October 1981, and she became titled as a servant of God, while she later became titled as venerable on 18th December 2000, upon the confirmation of her life of heroic virtue. Pope John Paul II beatified Barba in St. Peter's Square on 21st March 2004. Placing all our petitions before her today, let us pray. All-powerful and ever-living God, who, by the breath of the Spirit, inspire Blessed Maria Candida, the Virgin, to contemplate the riches of the Eucharist by her intercession, grant her, beseech you, that gratefully offering the sacrifice of the body and blood of Christ in union with the Blessed Virgin Mary, we may always glorify you in this sacrament, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God for ever and ever. Amen.
My dear friends, we continue our reflection on the Sermon on the Mount, taken from Matthew chapter 5, verses 38 to 42. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew. At that time, Jesus said to his disciples, "You have heard that it was said, an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. But I say to you, do not resist the one who is evil. But if anyone slaps you on the right cheek, turn to him the other also. And if anyone would sue you and take your tunic, let him have your cloak as well. And if anyone forces you to go 1 mile, go with him 2 miles. Give to the one who begs from you, and do not refuse the one who would borrow from you." The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. When someone strikes you on your right cheek, turn the other one to him as well. The reactions and actions that Jesus asks of us in these few verses are extraordinarily confronting. None of them come naturally to us when we have been hurt. And yet, they are the kinds of attitudes that the Holy Spirit wants to teach us as we submit our hearts to Him and let His love reshape the way we think and act. Have you ever noticed how infectious and life-changing the love of God can be? Anyone who has encountered it through a friend or a family member can testify to how it has moved them beyond what they thought they could ever accomplish. A recent news story gives a dramatic illustration of this point. It begins with the death of a young missionary woman who was killed by some young boys in South Africa, where she was serving. Hearing of their daughter's murder, the woman's parents felt that she would want them to understand the poverty and brokenness from which her killers came and to continue her work in the area. Consequently, they now spend most of their time serving the people in this town. Among other things, they gather donations to help business and improve education in the area. The couple has also met with the parents of the boys who killed their daughter and have offered their friendship and support. The boys spent 4 years in prison, but under a new program, they were pardoned so that they could return to society and help make it better. Surprisingly, the murdered girl's parents supported this move. When asked about their anger and hatred for what happened, they answered that those feelings don't have much effect on them. They have found peace and more so joy in the work they are doing. Maybe if you experienced a loss similar to what this couple did, you would find it within yourself to forgive. But when again, maybe not. What they did was awfully heroic. Nevertheless, wherever you stand in your ability to forgive, know that God can give you even more grace. So take some time today and see if any bonds of unforgiveness can be loosened by His grace. Thank you, Jesus, for the power of your love to transform me and make me more like you. Amen. My dear friends, the psalm urges singing joyful songs to the Lord. The purpose of this rejoicing is so that God can continue to reveal justice and salvation to all peoples. God continually demonstrates divine power in the wondrous deed which God performs. The psalmist, like Paul, in the first reading, urges believers to ponder the great things God has done in order to bring salvation, healing, health to all who will accept it. Let's pray that psalm now.
Your response. The Lord has made known his salvation.
The Lord has made known his salvation.
O sing a new song to the Lord, for he has worked wonders. His right hand and his holy arm have brought salvation.
The Lord has made known his salvation.
The Lord has made known his salvation, has shown his deliverance to the nations. He has remembered his merciful love and his truth for the house of Israel.
The Lord has made known his salvation.
All the ends of the earth have seen the salvation of our God. Shout to the Lord, all the earth. Break forth into joyous song and sing out your praise.
The Lord has made known his salvation.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen.
Prayer for relief from the coronavirus. Almighty and merciful God, who show your love to all creation everywhere, hear graciously the prayers we make for all those affected by the coronavirus in various parts of the world. We come before you asking for an efficacious control of the outbreak, for a healing of those affected, for the victims and their families. We thank you for blessing the efforts of our research scientists working on the development of a vaccine. We pray that these vaccines will be effective in combating the virus and its mutants and in controlling the spread of the pandemic. We pray that the vaccine be available for all our people, even the poor and those in rural areas. We pray for doctors, nurses, and health workers who are in the front line of this battle, that they be kept safe and have the strength and courage to continue their heroic efforts. We pray for the government and health authorities that they take appropriate steps for the good of the people. We make this prayer through Christ our Lord. Amen.
The Lord has made known his salvation. Pray for God's blessing now. May Almighty God bless you, the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen. We remember today all those who are celebrating their birthday, especially Avinash Borge from Mumbai, Anna Rosa Rodriguez from Goa, Carol Rodriguez from Abu Dhabi, Muriel Coutinho from Fathorda, Goa, Anand Vitus Desa from Abu Dhabi, Dion Lenville Pereira from Bengaluru, Mark Valado from Kumta, Karwar, Vinci D'Souza from Belman, Abu Dhabi, celebrating 60th birthday, and Edna Lavita D'Souza from Karkala, Nakre. Wish you all a happy birthday. God bless you. We pray for the departed soul of Jacob Paul Krasto from Kundapur. It's the 4th death anniversary. May the Lord grant him eternal rest. That's all for today, my dear friends. See you tomorrow. Bye-bye.